I would like to introduce you today's speaker from Control-S, Mr. Anil Nama. He is the CIO of Control-S Data Centers Private Limited, and this is one of the largest Tier 4 data centers. Anil is a veteran of IT industry with over 19 years of experience. He has been associated with armed forces and was later part of computer network defense and setting up of CERT team at IAF, including cyber forensics. He was instrumental in setting up the client series part of Airtel data center. Therefore, he did a brief stint with AKS IT services and as an information security consultant for NIC and Delhi Police. As a CIO at Control-S Data Center, Anil is responsible for solution and product architecture besides the new product development across the verticals. Anil would be talking about secure computing in the public settings, so which would really be a hot and the most prevailing trend in the industry. I'd welcome Anil to take on.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for there are two, three questions that I want to ask before I go ahead. A is the test. Test is nowhere related to what we are going to study there. So it is a surprise test to you. It is what a data center does, what is co-location and all those simple points. My intention is not to teach that. My intention is to teach something about security. My own experience says that security as a word is much abused, right? We have all sorts of securities in airport. Still, we have got Khanda type of things going on. We have all embassies secured. Still, you have that US ambassador being killed. So security is more qualitative and less quantitative. We can't quantify it. And the more we are afraid, the larger is our profile of security. My attempt here is to take you through a course that I designed basically for myself. It talks about information assurance. Ultimately, whether we do public clouds, whether we do in-house DCs, whatever we do, what are we looking at for? We're looking at for something which is known as information assurance, which means whatever money we have expended, whatever controls that we have put in place are able or do allow us to perform the information actions as and when or in the way that we desire them to do. The first question here is this
word or Apple iOS, right? We have most of the security solutions, focusing on a Windows or a Linux. But today, if you see, there is very few solutions which normally focus on Android applications as well as iOS. So we need a solution which do not focus on the operating system. It should be focused on the user request.
Right. Actually, what we are doing, we are using the cryptography to encrypt. Why was cryptography as a science developed? It was developed to store sensitive information or transmit it across insecure networks. So this science is not today's. This science was developed somewhere in the armies of Alexander's and all. If you go to history, it was used in those manners. I won't delve that much deeper. But essentially what happens, even in an hostile environment, where people are your enemy, people can look into your business, they want to know your secret. If you have to communicate, this science was developed. And this is out there in public domain. There is no semantic there. There is no RSA there. There is nobody there. It's a simple, plain science that can be adopted. We have strong words. Some people say strong cryptography. Some people say weak cryptography. They are all key lengths. But essentially, strong cryptography means you will use a larger key. Or if you take a safe analogy, you will have more levers in the safe, so that there are more combinations and it is that much more difficult for it to open. So how does cryptography work? It works very simple on simple assumptions. What are those assumptions? My enemy or my business challenger may know what am I using, what is my algorithm. It may know also how am I changing it. So what are those mathematical functions that can be used to change it back. It has also access to the data that I am sending. Let us say I have encrypted an email and I am sending it through Gmail, right? The Gmail admin may come to know what I am sending there. So he has the access to ciphertext. Adversary can know the corresponding plain text of ciphertext. How does it happen? For example, if you take an English language, the letter A would occur somewhere close to 17% of time. A blank space occurs 43% of time. See, if I just take a ciphertext and I do pattern matching, right? If more than 35% something is being repeated, my computer can immediately tell me this is nothing but a blank space. Or if it is being repeated between 11 to 16%, then this is the letter A. So sometimes we may even know what is contained there within the ciphertext, right? Finally, adversary can for some time feed specific plain text and observe corresponding ciphertext. So I have the algorithm with me. I want to bring out what is your text. I can put in A, B, C, D, A, B, B, C, D, and I can see what is the output and is it meeting the ciphertext exactly or not. The classic way how they do the password cracking. You have a word by the name of rainbow tables. You can use this to crack any password. Leave aside Windows and all, you can use that to crack any such passwords up to 16 alphabets. So these are our assumptions against which this science was there. The security of encrypted data is entirely dependent on two things. The basis here is only two things. One is, what is the algorithm that I am going to use, right? And B is the secrecy of the key. If my safe has got three keys or my car has got three keys and I keep one in the open and you take that car away, I can't claim that I have secured my car. So any such function or key that I use for changing a plain text to ciphertext or a ciphertext to plain text, I have to keep it secure, right? So this arises for three different setups. One is known as conventional cryptography. Another is known as public key cryptography. And third one is known as hybrid crypto systems. What is conventional cryptography? We both have the same keys. I lock it. Only you can unlock it. Assumption is, both our keys are safe. If the key goes out, gone, your total crypto system collapses. What is public key cryptography? Anyone? You would have heard it these days. Government is doing e-tendering. You have got RSA tokens and whatnot coming in. Any wild guess? Okay. The public key cryptography is different from conventional key cryptography in the sense you can use one key to lock it. You have to use the other key to unlock it. Right? There is one important thing which comes when we converse across domains. For example, I want to do business in China or US. I don't know that guy. Right? I can't have a key which I can mutually share with him. So now what happens? So I have developed a cryptography session in which one key can be used to lock unlock. If you have used one key, you have to use the other key. Now this other key, I will post it someplace. Those are known as certificate servers. Those are known as SSL certificates. Those are known as your VeriSigns, GoDaddy. That is what goes into your net banking. What they display is the public key. And even if you take and or go to the net or search for these SSL certificates costing from $100 to $1,000, they will give a insurance above $1 million. Which means if Anil Nama purchases a key for Control S and Anil Nama is not an authorized signatory of Control S and you can prove it, they have to pay that $1 million. This is the level that this science is there. This is how today we do internet banking, we do e-commerce, we do IRCTC, we do everything. Right? Here, concept is very simple. There are mathematical algorithms which allow for two large prime numbers. A system which is encrypted by one prime can be opened by the other prime. So if this other prime is visible against my name, then you can verify whom I am. And when I send my communication to you, right, you can lock it using my public key. Therefore, there is a non-repudiation, which means if I have said do this work, I cannot shy away and say no, this is not what I have written, because it was locked by my secret key, right? We'll come to that stage. So that is what is public key algorithm. Then we come to hybrid systems. Hybrid systems is something that is used by all OSs. If you go deeper into Windows, or you go deeper into Unixes, you go deeper into Oracle, whenever we log in, what is the login process? Login process creates a key for us in which there is resource levels, our group membership, and there are permissions. This creates our secure token or secure ID. Now, when I have to encrypt the data, like a Windows or a Unix system, what I do? I map it to a protocol by the name of Cryptos protocol. So first time you use PKI to log in. Thereafter, once your key is made, it is a secret key, the conventional cryptography, and it is always used to open all other logs. So this is the domain controller. I have logged in once. Now this has the secret key, my token which I have received as the secret key. I want to access a file from the file server. I will send my key. He will ask from domain controller, can you send this key? Both key matches, he will open the file to me. Right? So that is what is known as hybrid crypto systems. Public key are LGAML and RSA. An example of hybrid crypto system, here it is given PGP. The example is more aptly the Windows authentication system. I'll just move to my most important thing, the digital signature. So now I have to do business, B2B in pure sense. I don't know whether that Jabong company selling me an Arrow shirt is actual or not. And that Jabong company doesn't know, after I have given an order, will I not walk back, right? So what does it all constitute, this transaction, what does it constitute of? It constitutes of data integrity. Which means I said purchase doesn't go there as not purchase. Somebody cannot pilfer my data. If it is pilfered, people should come to know, right? Second is authentication. Jabong should know that I have only, from the way it will recognize me either as a banking guy or a credit card guy, whatever way his fulfillment process is there. He should have authentication that I am the person who is authorized, authenticated, and is willing to accept his transaction. Similarly, I should know it is a Jabong site, and he has that Arrow shirt, and he is going to give it to me. That is where his SSL certificate comes into play. Finally, non-repudiation. Tomorrow, I should not go back to my credit card company and say, "Bas, ye purchase maine nahi kiya." Understood? I can also say this card is lost, and during the period of my loss only this transaction was done. So there has to be a non-repudiation or a transaction or one-time password or something that setup put in place which ensures that it is me only who is doing that. Right? Now I told you about an analogy of e-commerce. Think it in normal email. An email I am sending to my sales guy and saying pick up the order at X amount. It goes through him, I'm sorry sir, and he is my adversary. He says or adds a zero to it, pick up at this level. So everything is gone because email is predominantly what we use. We never check the securities. Most of the communication happens to it. Within a fixed domain, we take it for granted that yes, it is secure. Right? So we will see how this digital signature is used in an email context. The most important here is our adversary or everybody knows what is the algorithms, they know the functions. So what is that value, or what is a value that I can create out of my message? That even if you know that value, you cannot create the number. So here the hash function is nothing, but when we used to do division, 11 divided by 3, we used to write remainder 2. Right? This is nothing but remainder. So now if you have remainder, which is this hash, if you have the number which is algorithm 3, then the number can be 11 the number can be 14, the number can be 17. You can never come to know what is the content. So that is the beauty of hash functions. Typically, we use 256-bit hashes. They're not so simple. They're large, right? But what happens in a hash is you do columnar and you do horizontal comparison. Any bit byte changing from the original, the hash will catch. Even if you know the hash, even if you know my algorithm, you can never construct the original mass. So this is the other secret integrand that is used by these setups. I will just go fast. Okay, so this is how the digital are supposed to take place. So you have World Wide Web in center. I am communicating in a business to business communication with an unknown entity. How do we validate each other? What happens? I will generate a message. From the message, I will generate a hash. And in this message, I will append the signature. This is without encryption. Open. The message content is known to all. What I want to prevent is, I have said tomorrow is a holiday. I don't want anyone to say tomorrow is not a holiday. Right? So what I do is, this token I will encrypt using my secret key. So when you receive it or your site Outlook receives it, it will find that token, go to the public site, the CA site of VeriSign or Government of India or TCS, whatever be it, download my public certificate, unlock it, compare the hashes. So my step one problem is over. Even though my data is moving through unknown World Wide Web, if it is changed, immediately the recipient will come to know that the integrity has been a problem. Second problem has been resolved. Once this is a receiver, because he is using my public key, he knows that it is me only who is sending. That guarantee is taken again by the third party or CA server. Right? So they cannot cross the boundaries. So this is how actually it happens in a conventional systems. In conventional systems, we have got RSA logins, tokens, all those things. They all use hybrid. So what they do is initially encrypt the public key. So I have to send data here or get his token. This may be an LDAP server, this may be a web server, this may be anything. I will encrypt the data using his public key. Now only he can open, because his side of key is supposed to be very, very private. It is not supposed to be known to anybody. So that way I am assured, then any data or the past message, if I have encrypted from the with the recipient's public key, there is only one guy who can open in this world, and that is the recipient. And that is how you establish secure communication in public or hostile environments. You will just see the adaptation of this in the second chapter. Any questions up till now, sir? So this is the science part. I'll come to the CISSP or the larger part in the second chapter. So we will. How come? Where is my presentation? Just now the file that I get. That is not the one which was open. Or it was open. Garavala Vaishyata. It does not contain the section 2. You have the earlier presentation? How do you think we can use the crypto systems now for our information assurance? Now if you can think of public cloud, you think of private cloud, you think of in-house IT, you think of out-house IT. Let me give you some stats. If you go through the security guys, you go through that antivirus guy, Symantec. First of all, they will come and say 70% of threats are internal. Right? You go through an ISO guy. He will take you less through the documentation of your vendors and more through the documentation of whether your employee has gone through this, how are you controlling his access, what are you doing what, right? Which means most of the threat to corporate data is unlike what we want to say that yes, we are a community of individuals, is from us only. And less of the threat is from the outside agency. Because outside agency, whenever we enroll, let us say somebody is coming to work inside our home, we will do a background check of it. Or we will at least go as to what is the work that he has done. Right? So these are the things, or this feudalistic attitude of ours, right, has basically dissolved the security domain and has led to arising of so many security companies. Right? For example, this PKI cryptography. I can tell you, for example, let us say PCI DSS, let us say RBI government, you take any regulation. What is the net effect we want? We want to say that if Anil Nama has done a fraud or has done a mistake or has done an action which is liable to be punished under the IT Act 2000, right? We should be able to catch. Now, if you make my ID under Windows as Anil Nama, can you catch me? You can make his ID also as Anil Nama, you can make his ID also as Anil Nama. Which means, you can never map under the laws, my name, onto your system. So, you take whatever compliance, whatever security system, RSA, to anyone blue coat, you will never be able to catch me. When I go and stand in the court of law, I will have a loophole to slip out. On the other side, you have got Government of India PAN card, you have got Government of India election card, right? When you go on to apply these RSA type of tokens from Government of India for 4,000 rupees only, and you use their CA systems to create those identities even inside your LAN, which means the heart, the authentication system is now outside. It is accessible to all. Think username, passwords are outside, right? Not allowed to be think by the IT vendors, by the systems. Right? When we talk about public cloud, when we talk about outsourcing, when we talk about really secure systems, we should never be afraid of where our data resides, where it is moving. We should have the robustness in place to ensure that we can do that. Right? So the second part of this study is something which is known as information assurance. It starts with how does a transaction happens on a site, and then we will move on to finally as to how do we create a process which we know for our company should have must work values and should have must not work values. So this is what I absolutely don't want. This is what I want, thereby leading to a neutral system. So this is something which is known as an e-commerce. Now here once again I want you to understand, system on the right hand side is a purchaser domain. He is nothing but a catalog like an Amazon, a Zabang or whatever it is. System on top is the transport system domain, which is FedEx, which may be in-house stores, which may be Reliance or whatever be it. On the right hand side are online business domains, which are nothing but merchant bankers. And on the bottom line are financial systems, which is your core banking systems, the EFTs of all the banks. So tomorrow if any bank says or any Visa says, I am secure, sorry, he is not secure. He is just like an airport, he is just like a railway. He is allowing all these systems, if you see, are allowing me as a purchaser to interact with them, which means I can give and take data from them. And if I am allowed to give and take data from them, then my data packets can also contain, or my luggage can also contain bombs, they can also contain anything. right? So whichever system in this world that you go to, however secure it claims, is not secure, but it is claiming to be secure because it has a perceived notion that it is vulnerable. You can't create a standalone banking system. RBI won't allow it. It can't calculate the CRR ratio. You can't create a standalone ATM system. Why? Because that ATM has to talk to the core banking. The core banking has to do, again, back-end RBI systems. Then these, your ATMs also go to US. They have got Visa numbers on them. Who authorizes that number? Is the Visa systems in US? Right? So anybody, everybody who says my system is most secure is the guy who has not done due diligence of his system as to what he must have, what he must not have. And he's only going by notional perception. It is high time that you, as the next lot who comes in, who replaces us, the old thought, understand these systems and develop those systems. So going in the same example, so, my God. I am drawing money, or there is a money transaction. What are the transaction paths in a commerce? It can be over internet, it can be over phone, it can be by mail, it can be by fax, or it can be by ATM. Right? All these are the ways we take out money. So you can have credit card systems there, you can have check systems, credit cards, all the ways and means in which you can bring out money. In any given single transaction, you will either use a credit card, a debit card, a check, a gift certificate, a score department or something that you have got, or use an ATM card. Each of these systems are not individual. Even if you use Rupa now, the other card after Visa and Maestro, it still goes to NPCI. So an SBI or an Axis Bank or whatever cannot say this system belongs to me. When you go to an ATM, right, in the ATM, the amount that is filled, the refueling of the ATM in terms of cash is not done by any ATM or the bank employee. It is outsourced district-wise by the RBI. Right? Now, when you can put in your ATM in one system, Bank of Baroda, and draw out your cash from SBI, which means even the banking system's back-end interact with each other. So what I mean to say is, in this world, there is no proprietary system. Each system is dependent on another system. And security is like a water pipe. If you put a pipe of 1 inch thick in an 8 inch dia, you can only pump in that much water. So because of there so much cross dependencies, these are the people who get vulnerable first. So very simple example. I will tell you, if you see here, credit card number is stored, employee runs away with it, individual will have a loss, the store may have a loss, potential publicity lawsuit. But if you see the exact guy who is responsible for all this, who is responsible for giving our credit cards, ensuring, maintaining, ensuring it is single one, cannot be duplicated, he has already covered his risk. You can never sue him. There will be RBI guidelines, there will be Government of India guidelines which protects him. Whereas we as an individual, when we got that card, we had full faith in our bank, was a duplicate nahi hoga. Right? That's why we applied for that plastic card. But if you go through the diligence, the information assurance system that these visas have built in, you will find that under the law you cannot prosecute them. That is the difference between perception and actuality. Right? But 5 minutes disturbance, I'll have to take five. So I'll not go deeper. You can take these slides. I've just given an example. I have tried to map all those things, and you will see the stores benefit, the financial institutions benefit, because they are better organized. They have got risk managers and they understand them. And we poor individuals are always at the receiving end because we never analyze. Fine. So I am leaving this example. Information assurance starts in very simple steps. Starts with physical security. That is why you come to a tier 4 data center. It is nothing but putting guards, putting biometric access, all those things and ensuring it is safe. The second thing that comes in place is the communication security. The communication security I have explained you, right? The third is computer security, which means I have today an option of using a Linux, a Windows, a AIX or a Solaris. Which is more secure for me? Can anyone tell? Right. So there has to be a comparison matrix amongst vendors. Then you have information security combined VNC. You can also call that as information security. You have operation security. This is where we are most audited. What is your admin guys doing? What is your operation guys doing? How you are getting material in? How you are dispatching it? That is known as only operation security. Then there is something known as system safety. We do our thing, right? All those pieces of equipment comes under system safety, and finally we reach system reliability. So I will not touch on physical security and ComSec. I will just touch upon CompuSec. Before 5 years, there was an orange book which came up with levels for anything. And these levels are something like this, A, B, C. Do you know Windows is certified at C2 level and Linuxes and AIXs and everything are certified again B1, B2 level. Which means if today I have to do an e-commerce site and if I go back 5 years, I can never port them on a C2 level, which is Windows and Linux would stop to function there. Why? You can see here. We say data protection, DLP is the new word in. What is data protection or DLP? Is nothing but the OS should understand the label and does not allow any labels that we don't allow. We say don't allow these type of files, it should prevent it. But as an OS, even B1 doesn't have it. Windows is C1, C2. You can never have a data loss protection policy in a Windows environment. You do whatever, you put in any number of semantics, there will always be a flaw. Because those guys don't understand labeling. So it will never go at kernel level. If it doesn't go at kernel level, it is a enforced process, that process can hang. The authentication system can be bypassed. Right? So you can never have a DLP till such time Windows come to the level of B1. Similarly, if you go here, configuration management and change management. This is the most abused word if you would have heard here. ITIL, remember? Not even HP which brought out ITIL. Its own HP Unix is certified at B2 level. It is still B1 level. And it doesn't have config management in place. So whatever we do on paper, it will never match what is there inside the system. Because the system was not developed to maintain that config management. If you go to a particular binary, for example, we change RPMs in Red Hat, we apply patches, right? All those patches takes the date of Microsoft patches date. It doesn't give me what are the binaries, what are the registry settings that I have changed. So if I want to make a true config change management register, I cannot make it. It is only available with IBM ZIOS and above. These are the words we keep on hearing. These are the words thrown to us. These were already there since 85. Right? And that is how the security domain is today. So I move ahead. After this all became black and white, people agreed, know how to use it. Suddenly there was a problem of comparing Oracle to DB2 or a Windows to Linux. So people came up with a new standard. They said that is all old. This standard is known as ISO 15408. It is also known as evaluation assurance levels. I won't go into techniques, I'll just go through the diagrams. There's a lot of design techniques that they test. These are the diagrams. So they have also come up with levels C1, C2, B1, B2, EAL 1 to level 7. So for example, I want to use a cloud for a PCI DSS setting. I have used RSA, a EL level 4 device. I am using a FortiGate firewall, EL level 4 device. What should be my hypervisor? Will I go with VMware? Will I go with Hyper-V? Will I go with Citrix? Now this design consideration can also come from here. Only Hyper-V and VMware are EL level 4 certified. You don't like VMware? You will have to use Hyper-V. You can't use Citrix. Citrix is a EL level 2. Which means all that encryption system that you put on place on top, you use a EL level 2, you never know what happens. Right? So whenever you evaluate systems, you will have to evaluate them at their level. The only shortcoming of these standards is, I will say my device is working like this and it will be standardized against that only. You cannot use one EL4 to compare four EL4s. You will have to go deeper line item, unlike the Orange Book. Right? Just a second, madam. So I have covered this OPSEC, the personal software administrative operations. We have got system safeties like electrical, mechanical. This comes against 14001. People who are there from manufacturing would know that. How do you safeguard the workplaces? Then you have system safety tasks. Then comes the system reliability. So when you take a summary of all these, you make a table as to what I want, what I don't want, what is my risk profile. I'll take IEL level 4, C1, C2, whatever. You can go deeper into it, study, make your own metrics. And say these are the devices that I will select from a security angle. Then you can correlate your risk with the vulnerability. Otherwise, every time there will be an antivirus out there, you will put in an antivirus, there will be an IPS problem, you will put an IPS, there will be a web application, put a web application. It will never arise from your own system design, right? So typically, this is how you will create the threats. This is how you will put in the measures. For this risk, I am putting an antivirus. For this risk, I am putting an authentication control, so on and so forth. And that is how, from the CCTA, actually the 27001 was made. So if you go delve deeper into 27001, the origins, you will get to know all these studies. What would they recommend? So this is how a basic protection workflow comes in place. And this is what is a CISO's role. So actually, it is the CIO from his functional design who creates the role of CISO. Today, we are not doing that diligence. We are not creating entropy of our systems. And that is why all these CISOs, when they come and sit on us, it becomes that much difficult for us to work. So finally, you will come out with something. This is my concluding slide. Simple, must work. And must not work. These are simple guidelines. My IT systems, these must work and these must not work. Once you have created an entropy and a guideline for you, that is your mother process. Any vendor comes, any change that you put in place should qualify. Right? This is another way of developing an enterprise architecture. Thank you. Any question? Or I think it was either everyone has understood.
Or not.
Something different brainstorming, where normal things was something people talk something on business perspective. It is something a different topic.
It is supposed to stimulate you, right? After all, you are tomorrow's leaders. Right, so please. Minimum key length is specified. Minimum key length today in public key is 1024 bits.
Yeah, but the governors can want to intercept the communication also, right? Like within an organization also, if there is an LST.
Boss, a second. If you do a fraudulent case, do you want to be tried by your government or do you want to be treated as a mercenary? If you want to be treated as a mercenary, whatever you are saying is right. I'll give you Indira algorithm, which is a separate algorithm. But if you want to be come under a rule of law, then you have to allow that law to intercept you. Otherwise, you will not be able to prove.
Correct. Like government will
No, no, you can go up to 10,000 bits.
Just as an example, okay. So government may have stipulated regulations saying that key strength of maximum 2014 bits is allowed. So above that, it is not allowed legally. So is there any such regulation in place as of now?
Public key, they already have the public key with them. They know you are the individual from your PAN card, from your bank records. They will catch you and get your key.
Okay.
Yes, you can formulate your own CA system. Yes, Windows allows that. But remember, Windows is an OS certified at C2 level. So the other achievements that you want to do from your CA system, the Windows itself would have vulnerability in keeping your keys in RAW.
But that is different, right?
I'm telling you, understand the inotropy. It is very, very must. What the idea says? Idea says is up till now, all of us as system admins kept Oracle DB passwords and admin passwords with us. This idea says, put it out in the open first, then go on to use it. Right? It's a radical change. So you have to think on those lines. You cannot, you can put in your own CA, you can generate your own SSL, but if you really do a commerce with a bank or with me or with him, you will have to come on a platform where I can recognize you. I cannot recognize you with your own in-house CA. So if you put your own in-house CA, once again the idea is being defeated. You are treating your information as your own proprietary, whereas it is an information of collective individuals, collective laws, collective governances. Right, sir? Thank you.
Thank you.